Hachette Audio presents Into Every Generation, A Slayer is Born, How Buffy Staked Our Hearts. Written and read by me, Evan Ross Katz, with additional narration by Deanna Anthony. To Billy Jacobson, who taught me unconditional love through meticulous practice, and Charisma Carpenter for everything and everything in between. I designed Buffy to be an icon, to be an emotional experience, to be loved in a way that other shows can't be loved. I wanted her to be a cultural phenomenon. I wanted there to be dolls, Barbie with kung fu grip. I wanted people to embrace it in a way that exists beyond, oh, that was a wonderful show about lawyers, let's have dinner. I wanted people to internalize it and make up fantasies where they were in the story, to take it home with them, for it to exist beyond the TV show. Joss Whedon, 2001. Pre-prologue. Can I start off a book about Buffy the Vampire Slayer with an anecdote about the Pulitzer Prize-winning rock opera Rent? On the one hand, who's going to stop me? On the other hand, must we? Verdict, we must. Rent made its Broadway debut in 1996, a year before Buffy premiered. The brainchild of composer-lyricist Jonathan Larson, it was hailed as groundbreaking from the outset for its depiction of queer people, the AIDS crisis, and the East Village art scene, and as a result, developed a cult following the likes of which were never before seen by a Broadway show. These Rentheads, as they came to be called, saw something in Rent that was bigger than just a Broadway musical. Rent became as much a lifestyle as a show. 6 years earlier, author Sarah Schulman published a novel called People in Trouble, based on a relationship she had with a married woman in the East Village during the advent of the AIDS crisis. Schulman alleged that the plot of her book and Larson's musical are eerily similar, with one noticeable difference. Larson reinterpreted the love triangle present in Schulman's novel, making the straight man the protagonist, whereas in Schulman's version, he was the secondary character. This bothered Schulman for a number of obvious reasons. Quote, at base, it's the issue of taking authentic material made by people who don't have rights, twisting it so they are secondary in their own life story, and thereby bringing it center stage in a mainstream piece that does not advocate for them. She ultimately deemed it an, quote, insidious but very American process. Why are we opening a book about Buffy by talking about a musical that had nothing to do with Buffy? Doubting me from the outset, I see you. Rent is a show that for many people allows them to feel seen for who they are or to gaze at a version of themselves that they long to be. It was gay, really gay. It was sex positive. It addressed the AIDS crisis in a substantive and meaningful way while dignifying storylines around drug addiction and homelessness. It no doubt changed lives by exposing a subculture to the masses and introducing it through the tools of empathy and catchy melodies. And if Schulman is to be believed, it's also an example of one man seeking, gaining, and reaping credit for something that might not have been his, and something that may have caused great harm in its repurposing. Buffy is not a direct parallel to Rent in this instance. Joss Whedon's concept for Buffy, both the series and the character, were not, to the best of our knowledge, in any way stolen, albeit admittedly derived from an amalgamation of characters seen on screen before her. But there is an undeniable parallel at play here in how we try to untangle the emotions wrapped up in how we viewed something at a particular moment in time and the formative nature of these memories with how we re-examine them through a new lens years, even decades later. Buffy remains one of the best television series of all time to this day, period, exclamation point. It's also a much different show now, 25 years later, than it was when it premiered. Buffy didn't so much break rules as create them. Much of the modern-day television landscape, particularly in the genre and teen space, is inspired by, grafted from, or at minimum, a nod to the groundwork laid by Buffy. It's a fact. Buffy changed lives. It changed my life. It's how I learned to quip. It gave me a sense of strength and certainty throughout a youth in which I often felt powerless. It even helped me to come to terms with my sexuality. Perhaps you can relate. It also ruined lives. I set out to write a book about Buffy the Vampire Slayer, the historic and groundbreaking television series that altered and then reshaped the television landscape, and in its wake, created a phenomenon with a still-beating heart nearly 25 years after the series debuted as a mid-season replacement on a fledgling network. This will not be that book. It will contain remnants of the book I set out to write. But as Catherine sings in the Stephen Schwartz musical Pippin, quote, things change, so does context. So with that, let the spell not be ended, but rather recast. Prologue. If you're listening to this, first of all, hi, and probably, likely, or most certainly, you've loved something with your whole heart. I just have a hunch. Not a person that provides reciprocation potential, but more like a thing, something you can give over your energy to in a way that feeds you and leads you to a deeper understanding of self or the world around you. Maybe it was hockey cards or Pokemon, Pogs or Tamagotchi, or maybe you're among the tasteful set and it was Mandy Moore's I Wanna Be With You album. Something that found you, undid you, rewired you, and so much more before you ever had the know-how, let alone the nomenclature, to understand. For all of my adult life, and the majority of my kid life too, that thing was a show I bet you're familiar with called Buffy the Vampire Slayer. That's the one with the blonde girl and the Dracula. Yes, Nana, go to sleep. There's a reason we're talking about Buffy 25 years after the show's debut and not Veronica's Closet. Don't get me wrong, I would love to write a book about Kathy Najimy's criminally underrated portrayal of Olive Massery, but not here and not now. This longevity in the form of regard and reverence is not coincidental or happenstance. There's a reason, a there, if you will. It's a reason we'll explore in depth and from varying angles with the goal of understanding why this show continues to transcend the medium. Why Buffy harnesses the rare ability to bring people, particularly those on the margins, closer together as a result. But this book isn't just for Buffy lovers. Not to worry, y'all will be fed. This book is a celebration of the culture vultures, those who do not like, but who love. Some might know this mode of being as stanning. That term derives from the 2000 Eminem song Stan, which tells the story of the fictional Stanley Stan Mitchell, a man who claims to be Eminem's biggest fan. He writes letters to Eminem and grows angry when he doesn't hear back, ultimately being drawn to violence over his unrequited obsession. The term took on a life of its own afterward, with many perceiving, perhaps by design, it to be a portmanteau of the words stalked and fan. Hyperbole gave way to irony, and the term reiterated over time to mean obsessed, in a good way. Stan armies were amassed online, and even artists themselves began acknowledging their stan bases. Lady Gaga and her little monsters, Beyonce and her Beyhive, Rihanna and her Navy. Soon, one couldn't just like a thing, they had to love it and be willing to defend their fave against the haters. At first, I could relate. I too love a thing. But then a meaninglessness started to percolate. In 2011, Britney Spears tweeted, "Does anyone think global warming is a good thing? I love Lady Gaga. I think she's a really interesting artist." More than 200,000 fans favorited this unintelligible non sequitur. At TPA at Y hashtag M hashtag hashtag at NYHN, Oprah tweeted in March of 2014, generating thousands of likes from fans for no discernible reason. When Lady Gaga tweeted the letter F in 2019, 250,000 people gave it a heart. Make it make sense. I couldn't. Over time, stardom gave way to unquestioning devotion and meritless defending. Rose-colored spectacles became the accessory du jour, and suddenly, to love something meant you could not question it. For to question it would put your love into question. To question it, you would be dubbed a fake fan. That was never for me when it came to Buffy. I love the show, but could never, and still can't ever, wrap my head around Buffy's love for Spike, a man who both stalked her and sexually assaulted her. Or why my favorite characters, namely women, were constantly killed off for no good reason. Or the enactment of the bury your gaze trope, the slut shaming, the tokenism. You want me to go on? So yes, my fave is problematic, and therefore I do not stand blindly. I will not push that aside in examining the profound and lifelong impact this show has had on how I and many others exist and function within the world outside of this show. In that sense, there will be a lot of gray area, something blue and seeing red, and all kinds of other strokes worth coloring in. And though there won't be blood, there will be referencing. From my POV, to love Buffy is to both contextualize and re-examine it. So that's what we're going to do. Something that's one part oral history, including interviews with the cast and crew, one part critical analysis, examining the show for what it got right and when it missed the mark, and one part fan notes, giving voice to the show's devotees who are the lifeblood of Buffy's ongoing legacy. And throughout, we'll be examining the problematic figurehead who created the show. I set out writing this book knowing we'd need to unpack several stories about Joss Whedon that had made the rounds over the years.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.